Have you wondered what the tech landscape of 2025 will look like? What are the emerging trends in AI, in 5G, or in quantum technologies? Or could there be an entire new trend on the horizon? Now, in today's discussion, we are thrilled to have Stephen Douglas. He's the head of market strategy at Spirent, and he is a visionary leader in both technology and innovation. Welcome, Stephen.
Thank you, Ronald. It's great to be here.
Yeah, you continuously track all the latest trends to shape your strategy, but can you share this with us as well? What are your top predictions for 2025?
Yeah, Ronald, one of the luxuries of being a test company is that we get a lot of insight sort of what's coming in the future. And I think there's four key areas we're monitoring closely at the moment. The first of those, it has to be around AI, but it's slightly different. It's something we call network infrastructure as a service for enterprise and sovereign AI. And what we mean by this is, in this current sort of early phase of AI, most of the hosting is being done in the large centralized data centers. But we're seeing a trend appearing at the moment due to government requirements for sovereign or data and privacy to be localized to a country or even to an enterprise, which is driving a demand to have that AI capability hosted locally. And we're starting to see the large telecom operators position themselves for this opportunity, in essence offering their hosting, but also their network capabilities to host multi-tenanted AI for both enterprises and for governments. So look out for that coming next year. We anticipate you'll see many of the telecoms operators look to leverage their capabilities around security, around the ability to deliver their network as a differentiated capability to provide the low latency, the edge processing requirements for localized inferencing. The second, I think, key sort of movement from a technology perspective we anticipate to see next year is around operation resilience. Unfortunately, in the last 12 months, we've seen quite a number of major networks have had outages, not just in the telecom sector, but across banking, in the transportation, and in the energy sector. And a lot of the time, those networks have been brought down or have had their issues due to cybersecurity challenges. And we do anticipate you're going to see more and more focus and investment moving beyond sort of how they can protect their networks to more how they respond and recover, and operational resilience becoming a key theme there. There's a lot of regulatory activity that's also driving this for the financial sector. It's new areas like DORA, which is looking for operational resilience. So we anticipate you're going to see a lot of focus in terms of how they can actually technically implement operational resilience, but also prove and validate its efficacy. Is it fit for purpose? The third key takeaway, it's got to be 5G. 5G has, you could argue, you know, it's reached the halfway point, or it's at halftime. You know, we're 5 years in, probably 5 years to go until 6G. But there's a lot still to play for in the second half of 5G. And we anticipate that you're going to see quite a lot of momentum over the next few months. From a lot of the testing we've done, there's a lot of focus on how operators can move to the next version, the standalone, which is really the true version of 5G, but also implement the next set of features called 5G Advanced. And you're going to see a lot of focus on new capabilities around reduced capability devices for industrial IoT, and also around fixed wireless access, one of probably the star players, 5G to date, which has had some of the most success, as it starts to move more towards enterprises and beyond just sort of targeting rural areas, but out into our urban and suburban environments. And the last one I think I should highlight is post-quantum cryptography. Quantum's a hot topic in most markets and most governments at the moment. It's seen as a longer-term horizon event, but one of the challenges we are starting to see, unfortunately, is that hacking groups have identified that if they could steal your data now, even if they can't decrypt it, they could harvest now and decrypt later when quantum computers become more available. So the risk is starting to manifest itself today. And that's driving a lot of proactive activity around implementing new, what they call post-quantum cryptographic algorithms, which could be brought in to actually provide you that security now. Now, it's going to take a period of time to implement those across our networks to provide that relevance or that security. But we do anticipate you're going to see a large number of mission critical enterprises, governments, and telecom providers start to implement that during 2025 and beyond. So look out for those top four things.
Yeah, I think three are really understandable. One really stand out and surprised me a little bit is this fixed wireless access as a key trend. Could you further elaborate on this? Can you explain this type of development?
Yeah, so as I said, fixed wireless access has been, you know, it's been one of the sort of the plus points of the early 5G adventure. It's had a lot of success in many of the markets where it's been deployed in terms of reaching new customers who maybe didn't have any access to cable or fiber in addition to mobile access. But it's also proved itself as a viable challenger for fiber and cable markets as well. And we're starting to see a lot of the service providers who focused on fixed wireless access now explore how do they move that forward beyond the success it's had. And there's really two directions we're seeing here. One is moving beyond rural markets, so starting to actually come into our suburban sort of markets where people live and challenging cable right at its, you know, on the doorstep. And doing that through a better performance and quality of experience is what's being trying to be delivered. The secondary one is really focusing towards B2B or enterprises, where fixed wireless access has a huge opportunity to provide not only network resilience for many mission critical industries, which need a backup facility in case, say, their fixed networks go down, but also for a lot of opportunities where a lot of industries have maybe, you know, remote locations. They have huge complexities of cost if they were actually going to have a fiber rollout there. So we're seeing a lot of focus now on how fixed wireless access can play towards enterprises and also how it can expand into the consumer market as well. So I think you're going to see a lot of focus in many markets next year around that.
And I like that part because it has the possibility to bridge that last meters, kilometers, even with fixed wireless access. And one other thing, beyond AI, of course, what other key technologies do you see as transformative in reshaping the world by the end of this decade?
Yeah, I mean, obviously, AI is going to be everywhere. But the one thing that we're seeing at the moment and we anticipate to be, you know, a mass adoption event is actually smart augmented reality glasses. And I don't mean virtual reality, I mean augmented reality. You know, as a glasses wearer myself, and a large percentage of the population, I think it's something like 2 billion people globally wear glasses. If you could provide a form factor as easy and as acceptable as glasses that could provide augmented reality, then that's a game changer because it breaks the adoption challenge which virtual reality has had to date with the larger headsets, with the more complex use and of how do we solve some of the energy constraints or, you know, I need a large battery packs. We're seeing a lot of focus from device manufacturers and glasses manufacturers at the moment on how they can turn traditional glasses and sunglasses into augmented reality types of wearables. And we do anticipate you're going to see a lot of that over the next few years. You'll probably still use your smartphone tethered to the glasses to provide a battery and to provide some of the localized processing. But the reality is this is a mass adoption capability because it's easy for people to accept. It'll be low cost, it'll be lightweight, and it's simply very easy to use rather than the larger virtual reality headsets. Now, it won't provide the same types of immersion, but the reality is it will provide a lot of services that you and I want to consume, whether it's reading an email, whether it's watching a news clip, whether it's watching sports, at the same time as using them as a set of normal glasses. So really do look out for augmented reality glasses coming over the next 5 years. There's a lot of focus within the industry around this, and we do anticipate this could be an adoption event which could even challenge the smartphone in the long run.
Yeah, I totally can envision that. I tried them myself as well, and you see now the manufacturers of sunglasses already creating these, but it gives you really a new type of user interface, easier to read, especially maybe used in the phone for all your actions, but for reading, I definitely think this is something that's going to happen in the coming years. Stephen, loved your predictions of smart glasses, but all the other ones as well. Thanks for your fascinating glimpse into the future. And to our audience, thank you for watching, and we look forward to seeing you next time.